Hey, Bridge Church Online. My name is Daniel Solis, and I'll be your Connections host today. Before we get started, I want to go over a couple things. First, second, and third time guests, go ahead and take out your phone and text the word card to the number 94,000. We want to make sure that we connect with you and also send you a small gift in the mail. Now, if you're a regular attender at Bridge Church, go ahead and take out your phones and text the word card to the number 94,000. We want to know how we can pray for you. We pray over these prayer requests each week. Now let's prepare our hearts and enter into worship.
All the time. lives into garden. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can.
One more time.
You turn graves into garden. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways.
Oh, still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness.
I'm still in your hands.
I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. I've never failed.
Oh, your promise stands.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness.
I'm still in your hands.
Son, we speak life over Michael Johnson today, and we
What an incredible time of worship. Now, before we get into the message, I just want to go over a few things. Next week, March 21st, we have an exciting day planned at both campuses. It's Hero Sunday. There's going to be baptisms, and we'll also be honoring our first responders and essential personnel. Go ahead and check out this video for more info. It's going to be an awesome day, and we hope that you can join us at one of our campuses. Now, there's always a lot going on here at Bridge Church, and we want to make sure that you stay in the loop. Go ahead and text the word update to the number 94,000, and you're going to receive a text message back with all the events happening. Okay, it's the second week in our series of Moving Forward in Generosity. Let's jump into the message.
Fam, thank you for joining us today here at Bridge Online. You know, this week marks the one-year anniversary of the shutdown of COVID-19 in our nation, and oh, what a year it was. But there is light at the end of the tunnel, and we just believe this year is going to give way, give birth to expanded freedoms, no longer having to wear masks, no longer having to limit the size of our gatherings. And we just remember the lives that were lost, and we know it's been a tough year for families and marriages and children, but we just believe that there is light, there is hope at the end of this dreaded tunnel that we've been in for the last 12 months, and with great expectation, I'm anticipating a great year here at Bridge, not only for our church, but for those who maybe are not connected to our church, maybe you just found us online. I just believe this is going to be a great year for you, and God's blessings are going to be upon you. You know, last year when we had to shut down our public gatherings here at Bridge Church and go totally online for about 8 to 9 weeks, we were in a series called Shift, which was a financial series. And in March, we're in another series called Moving Forward in Generosity, which is a financial series. And we're going to pick up with this message today. Don't be a monkey. Now, don't be offended, but just don't be a monkey. And we're going to look at 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6 through 8. It says, "Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a tearful giver. A cheerful giver. God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to bless you abundantly." Don't you like that? That God is able, that we don't serve a disabled God, that He is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. Now, I just want to tell you today, I want you to get this. God didn't create giving for His sake. He created giving for our sake. I'm reminded of the story of an elderly man who went to heaven and he brought a suitcase and met St. Peter at the pearly gates. And he was so happy to have his suitcase with him, he opened his suitcase and it was full of gold. Thinking that St. Peter would be astonished, St. Peter replied while he was looking at that just suitcase full of gold. He said, "Why did you bring asphalt to heaven?" Meaning this, that God paves His streets with gold, and gold doesn't really matter to God because God doesn't need our giving. We need to give for our sake because generosity is all about the heart. And when we're generous, it opens our hearts up to not only God, but to others. Reminded of the story of a hunter in India, and he figured out how to catch a monkey. And he understood the nature of a monkey. The nature of a monkey is selfishness. A monkey is real selfish. So he devised a trap in order to catch a monkey. And he took a coconut, a hard coconut, and he bore a hole in that coconut the size of a monkey's hand. And in that coconut, he put peanuts, and he also put some crushed bananas, some chopped bananas in that peanut, and he attached a rope to the coconut. And he put it on the path where monkeys traveled, and he got back a little bit holding the rope and just got hidden real good. And lo and behold, a monkey came by and smelled the peanuts and the chopped banana in the coconut. He was curious to the point that he stuck his hand in the coconut and grabbed a handful of peanuts and bananas. And at that moment, when that monkey grabbed hold of the bananas and peanuts, he was forever trapped because his nature is selfishness. He would not let go of the banana and the peanuts. You know, oftentimes we're like the monkey. We won't let go of the money that God's placed in our hands. And it becomes a trap. And just like the monkey, we are trapped by our own selfishness. And that Indian hunter was able to pull that monkey to himself and gain authority over that monkey. We would live in freedom. Because we don't live in freedom because we won't loosen our grip on the money that we're enslaved to. You see, don't be a monkey. Learn to be generous. Let go of what is in your hand. I have to learn to let go of what is in my hand. In Matthew chapter 19, there's a story of the rich young ruler, and he came to Jesus and he said, Jesus, what must I do? What good thing must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said, keep all the commandments, like love your neighbor and don't commit adultery and honor your father and your mother. And Jesus goes through this litany of commandments. And the young man responded by saying, I've done all these since I was a young man. And Jesus, wanting to get to the heart of the matter, said this, go sell all your possessions and give to the poor. And the word of God says this in Matthew 19, that the young rich ruler went away sad because he was very wealthy. See, he was acting like a monkey. He would not let go of what was in his hand to bless others. And ultimately, if he would have let go of what was in his hand, it would have blessed his life. Jesus said this, and I'm going to read the Passion Translation. He said, you can't worship the true God while enslaved to the God of money. I want to say it like this. I can keep my hand in the coconut. I can't keep my hand in the coconut and fulfill the purpose of God on my life. Meaning this, I can't be selfish. I can't be stingy and really accomplish the purpose of God for my life. Now, I want you to see this today. There are three things that we have to remember if we're going to get our hand out of the coconut and not be a monkey. First of all, we have to remember to give to God with a cheerful heart. Remember to give with a cheerful heart. This is the attitude in which we should give. You know, generosity is the attitude. Giving is the action. I'm going to say that one more time. Generosity is the attitude and giving is the action. That's right. Giving is the action. Look, he says, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart. See, giving is a heart issue. It is a heart issue that God begins to deal with our hearts. And he says this. He says, each one of you should give what you've decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful, say that with me, a cheerful giver. You need to hit the like button. You need to just comment right now. You need to share this post. God loves a cheerful giver, not a tearful giver. See, when I think about that word cheerful, I understand the word behind the word. That word comes from a Greek word, hilaros, which we get our word hilarious from, meaning that God wants us to be a cheerful, hilarious giver, not because we have to, but because we desire to give. God loves a cheerful or happy or hilarious giver. God wants us to be happy in our giving. Why? Because it belongs to the Lord. I can be happy when I give because I realize everything I have in my possession already belongs to God. Even the tithe, even the offering, even when I share with my neighbor, it belongs to God. When it comes to the tithe, Leviticus 27:30 says the tithe belongs to the Lord. So I'm not actually giving the tithe when I give to my local storehouse, my church where I'm being fed. I'm actually returning the tithe to God who owns it. You know, when you talk about being cheerful, I can give cheerfully because giving the tithe and giving offerings is an act of worship. The first time we see this word worship is in Genesis chapter 22, where Abraham is instructed by God to go to the Mount Moriah, to that region, to sacrifice his son. Bible says early the next morning he arose, he got all his things together, he took some servants with him. When he saw the region off in a distance, he told his servants to stay at that place, and he and the boy would go and worship, and they would come back. I want you to think about this. God connects worship with giving and sacrifice. There is no giving, true biblical giving, without the act of worshiping transpiring in my giving. So God wants us to worship Him, and when we give cheerfully, we're worshiping Him cheerfully. Think about that. And we give with the right attitude. Do you know you can give with the wrong attitude? We see that in Acts chapter 5, 1 through 11, where Ananias and his wife Sapphira sold some property, and they were going to give it all to the work of the Lord, but they kept some for themselves, and they lied to the Holy Spirit, and both of them died that day at the feet of the apostle because they were deceptive, because they lied against the Holy Spirit. And the Bible says fear came upon the church. How many of you know they gave, but they gave with the wrong motive and attitude? We have to check our attitude. Are we giving cheerfully, or are we giving tearfully? Number two, we have to remember to give generously. This deals with the amount. Say the amount. Generously. It's giving generously. Generously describes what kind of giving we're going to do. We're going to give generously of the tithe. The tithe is the first 10% of our increase. You know, it says this in Malachi 3:6, where God was dealing with the nation of Israel about the area of financial integrity. He says, I, the Lord, do not change, so you, the descendants of Jacob, are not destroyed or consumed. And within the context of this, God is instructing His people to return back to Him. And they say, how shall we return to you? He says, with the tithes and the offerings. Return to me. The tithe is the first 10%. They were robbing God. They were robbing God of what was due Him. And so God tells them to return, to repent, and see, will I not open the windows of heaven and pour out upon you a blessing that you'll not have room enough to receive. So the tithe is a tenth. It's the first tenth of your income. It's not the last tenth, the middle tenth. It's the first tenth. Why is it the first tenth? Because when you give to God first, you're exercising faith. And faith, according to Hebrews 11:6, without faith, it's impossible to please God. So when I take the tithe off my gross income and I give it to God first, guess what I'm doing? I'm operating in faith, and I'm putting God first. It is the first fruits of all my increase. Solomon said it this way, honor the Lord with the first fruits of all your increase. So we honor God first. I want you to say that with me, first. We put God first. The tithe actually belongs to the Lord. It belongs to the Lord. I'm going to say that one more time. It belongs to the Lord. See, most people think, well, that was under the old covenant, but you got to understand, tithing actually was talked about 500 years before the law. It was talked about 2,500 years before the law, and it actually can be seen in the Garden of Eden when God planted a tree in the Garden of Eden and said to Adam and Eve, don't touch the tree that stands in the garden, in the middle of the garden. So when you touch it, you will surely die. God was getting them to practice the principle of first. God wanted them to practice putting Him first. And that tree represented the first fruits of the garden. Now I want you to understand that it represented the first fruits of the garden. So when we tithe, we're putting God first. And it goes over into the new covenant where Jesus in Matthew 23:23, He reiterates this and reaffirms tithing. He's talking to some Pharisees and He says this, woe to you teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. Jesus was pretty brutal on religious people. He said, you give a tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin, but you have neglected the more important matters of the law, justice, mercy, and faithfulness. You should have practiced justice, mercy, and faithfulness, the latter, without neglecting the former, which was the giving of the tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin. Meaning this, you practice all this thing called justice, mercy, and faithfulness, but don't forget about tithing. Jesus did not do away with tithing in the New Testament. He reaffirms it, and in Hebrews chapter 7, it actually says this, that when we give to men who will eventually die, but not only are we giving to men, we're actually giving to Jesus who lives forever. He's an eternal God. And so when we give our tithe, we're not just giving to a church that we attend, the storehouse where we're getting spiritually fed. We're actually putting it in the hands of Jesus, and he sees the tithe. Malachi 3:10, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough to receive it. Look at there. God says, if you'll bring the tithe into the storehouse, I've got a guarantee. Here's the guarantee. That I'll open up the windows of heaven and pour out upon you a blessing you'll not have room enough to receive. Now, the windows of heaven is not a literal window that opens up over your head. The windows of heaven are the people that God assigns to your life to bless you. Given, it will be given, shaken down, pressed together, will men give unto your lap. God assigns people to bless you. Every time God wants to bless you, he sends a person. Every time the enemy wants to curse you, he sends a person. God uses people and the enemy uses people. God uses them in a positive light. The enemy uses them in a negative light. God wants to bless you and I, but can we practice the principle of tithing? And number three, we got to remember this. If we want to get our hand out of the coconut, we don't want to be a monkey. We got to remember God gives grace. He gives the ability. We talked about the attitude. We talked about the amount. And we talk about the ability now, the ability. When you think about tithing, especially for somebody who has never tithed before, never honored God this way, it can be an overwhelming thought to take 10% of your income and give it to God. There are two testimonies that I've heard from people over the years. The first one is from a tither. They constantly say, I am blessed. God has blessed me beyond measure. God has been faithful to me. And there's a second testimony of a non-tither. Here's their testimony. I can't afford to tithe. Here's the secret. You can't afford to tithe until you tithe. Why? Because God removes the curse of mammon, which is greed, and the spirit of this world off your money when you tithe, because the 10% sanctifies the 90% that you have, and God multiplies it and blesses it because you've honored him first. So the ability, I want to talk to you about the ability. Look what he says in 2 Corinthians 8:7. Paul says this, writing to the church at Corinth, taking and receiving an offering for those Jews in Jerusalem who are poor. He says this. He says, each one of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly, but and not under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. He says this in chapter 8, verse 7. He says, see to it that you excel in the grace of giving. Look here. He says, see to it that you excel in the grace of giving. He calls giving a grace. That word grace in the Greek is charis. It actually means gift, the gift of giving. That gift comes with supernatural empowerment. It's the ability of God for you and I to give. It is a free gift. Not only does God give us the ability to give, He gives us the heart to give. I'm telling you, when we submit to God, He gives us the ability to give. You say, I can't do that, Pastor. I know you can't do it. But God, through you, can. The Holy Spirit working in you. Holy Spirit empowers you to give. The Holy Spirit empowers you to be generous. Acts 1:8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses. And we think witnessing is just opening our mouths and telling people about Jesus. That's part of it, but it's becoming what God has destined you to become. God wants His people to be generous, and He gives us the ability and the power to become that generous witness. Come on, we become a witness of generosity when we say, God, I'm going to put you first. I'm going to give you 10%, and then I'm going to give you an offering when times comes to give offerings to building funds or to missions and to other things, and then I'm going to be a witness because I'm going to be generous to the single parent mom and to my neighbor and people I meet on the streets. I am going to be a generous witness. How does that happen? It doesn't happen in your own strength or might, because giving is a gift. God gives you that ability to give, and He gives you the attitude to give in the right way. I'm telling you today, God gives us the right heart and the power to give when we submit our lives to Him. I love this verse of Scripture in Ephesians. Paul wrote Ephesians 3:20. Now unto Him who is able. That's it. Able. God is able. Now unto Him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you could ask or think, according to the power that works within you. When I begin to line my life up in the area of biblical generosity and biblical finances, I put God first by tithing. Guess what? God is able to make all grace abound to me. Look here, verse 8 of chapter 9, 2 Corinthians says, and God is able to bless you. Can I tell you right now, you don't serve a disabled God. You serve an able God who's able to bless you right in the middle of famine, right in the middle of COVID-19, right in the middle of job loss, right in the middle of a dysfunctional situation. God is able to favor you and bless you and raise you up as you honor Him to be a witness in the world. He says God is able to bless you abundantly. How does God bless us? He blesses us abundantly. Why? So that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. Not only does God want us to have all that we need, but He wants us to meet the needs of other people so we can abound in every good work. Hallelujah. That is what it's about, people. It's about not only having our needs met, but giving to missions and giving to church plants and giving to single parent moms and giving to all the things we give to. Why? Because God is able to raise us up to be a witness of generosity in a world that is acting like a monkey. Every time you get paid, you have an opportunity. Are you going to act like God? Or are you going to act like a monkey? God empowers you to act like Himself. The flesh empowers you to act like a monkey. I don't want to be a monkey. I want to be all that God has called me to be. See, when we tithe, we're actually given to Jesus. Look what Hebrews 7:8 says. In the one case, the tenth is collected by men who die. But in the other case, by Him who is declared to be living. Meaning this, when we bring our tithe in the new covenant, it's not collected by an Old Testament priest. It's collected by Jesus Himself. And it actually gives testimony of His resurrection. Today, I want to encourage you. Don't be a monkey. Come on, don't be a monkey. Be godly. Let's pray. Lord, I just thank You that You've given us an opportunity, Lord, to hear Your Word, to learn from Your Word, to be instructed by Your Word. I just pray that You'd redeem the time in our lives, Lord, and that we would be people, Lord, that have the right attitude, the amount, and the ability. You're causing us to rise up. And Lord, every time we tithe, you're rebuking the devourer from devouring anything in our lives, Lord. And we honor you. We put you first in everything we do and say, in Jesus' name, amen. I want to thank you for joining us today here at Bridge Online. I want to thank you for your faithful generosity. It means the world to Bridge Church as we continue to expand. Even during COVID-19, we continue to expand and grow and give and honor God in many ways. See, our mission here is to connect all people to the person, power, and purpose of Jesus. And as we give, we're able to do that. We give together. Today, like every Sunday, we're going to receive our tithe and offering. Thank you for your giving. Multiple ways you can give. You can text the words give now to the number 94,000. You can also give through our Cash App. You can actually mail it if you use snail mail. Whatever you choose to use, whatever method you use for giving, we want to say thank you so much. We love praying for you. If you need prayer this week, just text the words, please pray, to the number 94,000. Our staff prays over them, not just once a week, but they get to my desk and I read over those and I pray over those constantly during the week as God just brings them to my memory as I read them and as I lay my hands even on those sheets of paper in my office and even in my home as I pull them up on email. God just blesses you richly. I just believe he's blessing you in every area of your life, in your family, in your finances, in your health, in your mental well-being, that God is able to bless you. We love you. Thank you for joining us today. Be blessed, and we'll see you next week here at Bridge Online. Looking forward to it.
Now, wasn't that a great message on moving forward in generosity? Before we end our time together, I just want to remind you of a couple things. First, second, and third time guests, and also regular attenders of Bridge Church, go ahead and take out your phones and text the word card to the number 94,000. We want to thank you for your generosity. Your continued financial support allows us to continue the mission of connecting people to the person, power, and purpose of Jesus Christ. You can give a couple ways. You can text the words give now to the number 94,000 or use our Cash App. Now, we hope you have a great week, and we can't wait to see you next week here at Bridge Online.